This program is a production of SECA. Funding for Firing Line is made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation, L. John Polite, Jr., the Friends of Firing Line, and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Welcome to Firing Line. I'm Bob Shrum, a Democratic political consultant who has been trying mightily and will continue to try to elect a president that Bill Buckley can heartily detest. In a sense, it's very hard for me to introduce Mortimer Adler, not because there is too little to say, but far too much. He is a philosopher, the guiding spirit of the Encyclopedia Britannica and the great books, a teacher and the author of nearly 50 books of his own. Yet there is a common thread that runs through everything he has done. Mortimer Adler has sought to rescue reason, faith, and sometimes God himself from what many regard as the agnostic, chaotic rubble of modern thought. In the past, he's written a book arguing that the existence of a supreme being can be proved logically. And then, like a 20th century Thomas Aquinas, he turned his formidable gifts to the task. Now, in his newest book, Truth and Religion, he has put faith to the test of reason and argued that the plurality of beliefs must be measured by the unity of truth. When I was growing up, and I think Mr. Buckley was growing up, we were both taught about an error called indifferentism, the heresy that all religions are equally valid, the notion that tolerance is equivalent to truth. Mortimer Adler is not an indifferentist. In his new book, he doesn't tell us which religion to choose, but sets out how we ourselves should decide. He describes the quantum theory and the limits of science, and seeks to restore philosophy to its central role as logic, metaphysics, the key to ultimate truth. Philosophy, in short, can take us where science cannot go. Each of three world religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, claims a singular divine revelation. And Mortimer Adler leaves us with this question: which of them has a greater claim to truth? So now we begin with a question from Mr. Buckley. Bill, I assume you believe that there is only one true religion. Do you think it can be proved by reason alone? And if it can, what role is there for faith and grace?
Well, that's a double-barreled question. I think if I may, I'll take the liberty of whittling off a part of it in order to address the theses of Dr. Adler's book, in which he insists that certain things about religion are specifiable and provable. Certain other things, he uses the word poetical, belong to that poetical part of religion, in which, of course, faith and imagination play a larger part. But then you go on to say something very, very interesting, which is that that much of poetry which conflicts and makes incompatible the basic philosophical postulates of religion have got to be discarded. Now, what do you mean by that as a practical matter? The isolation of superstition?
No. It's demythologizing mm-hmm. religion, but that is really a side point, I think. Well, the real problem is that the extraordinary thing about articles of faith, when one understands what faith is, no article of faith can be proved. It is faith because it's beyond proof. But though articles of faith in any religion are unprovable, they are capable of being, shall I say, challenged by science and by philosophy, because all truth must be consistent. And if any article of faith is contradicted or contrary...
It becomes superstition.
Yeah, that's right. And the reason why in the book I'm so insistent upon the challenge of averroism is the other claim that truth is not one, that there can be two truths.
Why don't you define averroism before you go forward?
Well, Averroes was a Arabic philosopher in the century before Aquinas. And he was challenged by Al-Farabi, another Arabic philosopher who was a very devout Muslim, in a book called The Destruction of Philosophy. Al-Farabi says that only the faith was true, that Aristotelian philosophy was not true. In reply, Averroes wrote a book called The Destruction of the Destruction, in which he argued that there were two truths, the truths of faith and the truths of reason, and they didn't come into conflict. But he meant by the truths of faith those which are poetically true, truths of the imagination, and the truths of Aristotle, the truths of reason. And so Aquinas challenged him on the grounds that the truths of faith were not just poetical, they were logically true, factually true, in the same sense the truths of philosophy and science were true. Though that kind of, if you stuck to the realm of logical or factual truth, there's only one realm of truth, and all parts of it, mathematics, history, the hard sciences,
art,
philosophy, must be consistent.
Well, now, let's apply what you just said to the conflict involving Galileo. Galileo, as I remember, said, that which we know circumstantially, empirically, is as certain as though it were told to us by God. He then made the spectacular misapplication of this in a cosmology,
yeah,
which was believed for a few centuries, but was proved by Einstein, in fact, to be incorrect.
Just think for a moment. At the time of Galileo, and of the century before that, the world was very small. The cosmos was very small.
Mm-hmm.
Really, the solar system was the cosmos. So that when Aquinas talks about heaven or hell, he's thinking of places.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, they're not places. They can't be places because they were in the imagination of the Middle Ages. What we know about the far-flung galaxies of this extraordinary expanding cosmos, you can't talk about heaven or hell as places. And
well, so now, wait a minute. You see, you can't talk about it. Does that mean that that the metaphors have to be jettisoned?
Well, you must not say, when, for example, in the Creed, you speak of Jesus on the third day ascending into heaven and sitting on the right hand of the Father, that cannot be literally true, cannot be factually true, because there is no sitting in heaven, and God has no right hand. I mean, that's metaphor. So that you must interpret that in such a way that it is consistent with the cosmology you know.
It's anthropomorphism.
That's right. Yeah. It was perfectly understandable why the Creed should have said that at a time when the cosmology was as poor as it was.
Well, now wait a minute. Are you saying that we can't read Milton in this century with Prophet?
Oh, sure we can. It's wonderful poetry. Mm-hmm. But you must not read it as though making...
As though you're getting the celestial architecture.
That's right. Mm-hmm. As if you're making literal statements of fact.
Yeah.
Because any statement of fact must be consistent with every other statement of fact. You can't have two truths. I mean,
one must exclude the other.
That's right.
Yeah.
For example, let me put the hard test on this one. Let's suppose that, as I think is the case in that book I wrote about the how to think about God, that philosophical theology is transcultural.
Mm-hmm.
That what that proof asserts, that one can prove the existence of an infinite spiritual being, is true worldwide.
Yeah.
if that is true, if that's philosophically true and logically true, then the Eastern religions
are false.
Some of which are non-theistic are false. Some of which are polytheistic are false. In other words, polytheism is false, and the cosmological religions of the Far East that have no God at all.
To the extent that they're derivative.
That's right.
Yeah.
So that if you use Western philosophical theology as a factual truth that everything must be consistent with, then there are only three religions that can claim to be true: Judaism, Islam, and
Christianity. Well, now, this transcultural becomes almost a truism.
That's right.
What is it, other than invincible ignorance, that would account for the failure of these other cultures to acknowledge your point?
I don't know the answer to that question. These are all relatively ancient religions, have a long history, and
they have modern exegetes and modern beliefs.
On the other hand, I don't think the logic of truth accepts it in the East. See, I think all of the Eastern cultures, the Hindu culture, the two Buddhist cultures, the Chinese Taoism and Confucianism, and Shintoism, are all averroists in some sense. They're willing to. I gave a lecture, as the book contains the lecture I gave in Tokyo, had a very interesting audience at the National Club, and I challenged them about the fact that they could not keep their religions in one part of their mind and their physics and technology in another. Mm. They were not in any way disturbed by the inconsistency of those two things.
Well, but in your book, you also say that this attempt to maintain two incompatible truths as your lodestars cannot work. Now, if it cannot work, then mustn't the day be predictable when the truths of the rational structure overwhelm the superstitions?
I would think so. I would remember that one of the last things that Toynbee wrote was an essay that predicted the imminence of a world religion. I would think that it's only in this century that technology, physics and mathematics have become effectively transcultural. I mean, there is no Chinese physics, there is no Japanese physics, no Hindu physics, or mathematics, or technology.
Was there in a preceding century? I mean, the wheel was always round, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, but the point I'm trying to make, the cultures did not adopt Western technology until...
Oh, I see, yeah.
I mean, in some sense, the whole world has been Westernized by technology, has it not?
Mm-hmm.
It's our Western technology, our Western mathematics, and our Western physics. And those subjects are in China and India as well as they are in Southeast Asia and South America and Africa, correct?
And do you predict that they will, in due course,
In due course, people will be aware of the fact that they're acting and living and using the truths of these transcultural elements of their culture. Requires them to face up to the inconsistency between what is asserted logically in technology and physics and mathematics and what they hold in their religion.
Well, now, are you talking about the conscientious intellectual elite? Because after all, you can really say that there has been a dissipation in our own culture of people who make the logical connections during the past 75, 100 years.
Let's take Campbell. Of the various alternatives that I've presented in my book, one is that no religions are true. According to Campbell, all religions are misinterpreted mythologies.
Mm-hmm.
They should be taken as poetically true or as forms of poetry, but not as having any logical warrant at all. That's Campbell. Let me read you the alternatives for a moment. Campbell is one of them. All religions are misinterpreted mythologies. None is true. You're using the word truth now as a logical, factual truth.
Yeah.
And here are the other alternatives. Only one of the world's religions is completely true. All the others share some of that truth and mixing it with falsehoods and mistakes. Second, all of the world's great religions contain admixtures of truth and error, with one of them truer than any of the others. All can be graded in the degree of truth they possess from more to less. Three, with regard to its orthodoxy, the one religion that is truer than any of the others is not yet completely true, but can and should look forward to further development in which certain of its beliefs are expunged and others are added to it, making it, as nearly as possible, completely true. And four, with regard to its orthopraxy, that is, I make the distinction between orthodoxy, mm-hmm. right belief, and right ceremonials, right rituals, right precepts. With regard to its orthopraxy, a religion that is false in its factual or descriptive beliefs may be true in its moral or... I think there's common to all religions of the world, there are certain simple moral precepts that are common.
What you call the common law,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. And five, while some of the world's great religions are true in certain respects and false in others, some religions are completely false. Now, I would say that no religion is completely false. None of the world's religions are completely false on the grounds of their, shall I say, their precepts. I mean, they all, in some sense, they all share the golden rule in mm-hmm. some crude, loose sense. And they all have the natural moral law in them somehow. So there's only in their orthodoxy, what their beliefs, their assertions of what is... See, they all are full of factual assertions, are they not?
Sure. But also some of them lend themselves to certain practices.
Oh, yes.
That are forbidden by competing religions.
After all, just think of the three Western religions. The ceremonial precepts of Judaism, the ceremonial precepts of Islam, and the ceremonial precepts of Christianity are all inconsistent. Mm-hmm. I mean, think of the dietary laws in Judaism. Mm-hmm. Think of the prayer requirements in Islam. Think of the forms of worship in Christianity. They're not consistent with one another, are they?
No, they're not. They're not consistent. But do I understand you to be saying that that inconsistency doesn't stand in the way of the principal postulates, reasonable postulates of their faith?
You see. Is if the Jewish religion declares that the Old Testament is the Word of God, mm-hmm. and if the first five books of Moses, the Pentateuch, is the heart of the Old Testament, prophets following historical books, then the dietary laws, the dietary prescriptions, are part of Orthodox Judaism. Mm-hmm. And when Christ says that the two precepts of charity, thou shalt love thy God with all thy heart and all thy soul and all thy mind, and the neighbor of thyself, on these two precepts hang all the law and the prophets. He's dismissing the Old Testament law and saying, substitute these precepts of charity, is he not?
Well, was he understood to be saying that?
I think so. See, I think Paul is saying, and Paul follows him in saying, that if you're a Christian, you're dispensed from observing the Jewish precepts. Because when you take Christ's two precepts of charity, that... He says, on these hang all the law and the prophets.
Yeah, but what I want you to answer a little bit more directly than you have is the following question. If you can foretell the collapse of the non-rational aspects of...
religion.
Of the religions you cite, the Hinduism and the Shintoism.
About ten.
Yeah.
Seven Eastern.
Then why can you not forecast... a recognition of the truths of religion within our own culture?
Because our own culture, I think, in the 20th century particularly, is dominated by a philosophy that's made a mockery of truth, positivism. The assertion that the only truths we have are the truths of science, I will not do. Moreover, the word truth has become the most unused word in our universities. I mean, the logic of truth is so exacting that most professors have nothing to do with it.
Well, most of them don't believe it exists.
Right.
Yeah.
See. The greatest of the most extraordinary of the modern philosophical errors is idealism. That the world is of our making. There is no independent reality to which we are responsible. Without an independent reality, truth becomes a kind of figment.
So therefore, you acknowledge that there are sort of Miltonic forces of corruption.
Yes.
That stand in the way of the of a penetration, mm-hmm. of the correct paradigms.
I think in the 20th century, I think this book of mine is really the first book in the philosophy of religion that takes truth seriously. Mm-hmm. Most of them are sociological books. Most of them are comparative religious books. Most of them say always religious. Indifferentism. And indifferentism is one way of throwing truth out the window.
As Mr. Shrum said, right. And in order to rout that, do you need a racist nation, or do you need evangelism, or both?
I think I hope that in the century to come, we not only will see an approach to one world, politically and economically, and also in the West, a defeat of modern positivism.
Well, why do you conjoin the one to the second? why do you have to have one government?
You don't have to.
So you're simply expressing a basket of hopes,
right.
Not a related.
That's right.
This one world, one government business goes back to an old fancy of yours, doesn't it?
And I shall have something to say about that in the book coming out in March.
Which we will discuss on this program.
That's right, I hope so.
there are then grounds for being intellectually optimistic, as I understand you, to the extent that technological truths and scientific truths have irradiated throughout the universe. One would assume that...
I don't think at the moment, if one looks at the academic world of Europe, England, and the United States, there is much hope for philosophy. I see no signs of any correction of the 20th century errors. But if the argument goes on, the truth must win, must it not? If we carry the argument on, the only way in which the truth can be defeated is by people who say there is no truth, which that has to be defended. But anyone that's willing to admit that there is truth and error in science is caught by that much, at least, of evasion of skepticism. And one has to show the same kind of evidence that makes some scientific hypotheses false and others correct, or one more correct than another, applies to philosophical conclusions as well. Mm-hmm. The burden of all my writing in the last 10 years has been that way. And I'm hoping that I convince my opponents or persuade them. But you say, are there signs of hope at the moment? No, there are not.
Yeah, if you play golf and there isn't a hole towards which to drive the ball, then you are helpless, aren't you?
Right.
Yes.
Gentlemen, our time is up. But I believe this half hour has probably provoked people to think more deeply about some timeless truths. I am struck by Mr. Adler's optimism that religion can survive the test of truth, that it is not an act of blind faith, a simple assertion of will in the darkness, inconsistent with the work of intellect. But I'm not sure how much closer this brings us to any sense of certitude about religion. So I think I'll put the question to Mr. Buckley. Is it getting harder or easier to believe that there is one true faith?
Well, Dr. Adler, in three or four books, has slowly narrowed the field. Two volumes back, he concluded that there must have been a prime mover, that ex-nihilation is a necessary philosophical concept. Now, he comes in this book further narrowing the field by insisting that that which is scientifically provable has got to be compatible with that which is thought or believed. All of us who read these books have a feeling that there is a momentum gathering which will explode when?
I think after I'm dead.
Well, I hope that will never happen.
I'm not planning on it. I'm not
any way of repealing that?
No.
Well, are you at free? Do you feel free to tell us simply the title of the book that will conclude, so to speak, this particular narrative, philosophical narrative?
Yes, a book that will appear in March 1992, called A Second Look in the Rearview Mirror. The second part of my autobiography, in which my own dealings with religion will be treated.
And when was the first one published?
1977. So it's about 20 years later.
So the Hajara was 13 years. Mm-hmm. And we'll close the program without asking you to give us a preview of that that book. Thank you very much, Dr. Adler, the author of Truth and Religion, Truth in Religion. And thank you, Mr. Shrum, and thank you, Darwin.
Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation. L. John Polite, Jr., the Friends of Firing Line, and by the financial support of viewers like you. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.
This is PBS.
William F. Buckley, Jr. offers 20 years of Firing Line guests from the 60s to the 80s. For $19.95, you can receive this companion book by calling 1-800-872-8188.